is going to be 1 Corinthians 1:30. But of him are ye in Christ, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to pray for Brother Ricky and Brother Michael that you would give them both strength to speak, that you'll bless them for bringing your word, and I ask your son's name, amen.
Well, I'm not going to need a step stool either, so. I have not been able to be with you during all these meetings, but we're going to see a demonstration of the unity of the Spirit if I speak the same thing that you've been speaking, so. And I know that's going to be the case. We all have the same teacher, right? So that's the way it is. Christ is made unto us sanctification. My message to you tonight is this, that it is in your personal fellowship with Christ that is the place in which you are sanctified and prepared for the world to come. So that's going to be what I'm going to say tonight. What is sanctification? I'm sure that you've heard this and you'll continue to hear it. Sanctification is being set apart. We have this exhortation in Scripture, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Of course, if you're going to live separately, you got to first be separate, right? Be separate. There are a lot of good examples of separation in the Scriptures. My mind was drawn back to the law. There's a time when God made a distinction between clean and unclean animals. God would not let Israel just eat any kind of animal, you may recall. And they weren't allowed to eat things that creeped along the ground. But God did make an exception in Leviticus chapter 11, 21 and 22. He said, yet these may ye eat of every flying, creeping thing that goeth upon all fours, which have legs above their feet, to leap withal upon the earth. Now, that's a marvelous picture of what separation is. The only kind of animal you can eat to remain clean is an animal that is able to separate from defiling influences, which is what the earth is. And by the way, that's what a believer is. He's someone that is able to leap off the earth, like a grasshopper. Leap off the earth. You know, grasshoppers don't crawl along the earth. They leap to get where they're going. See? And that's what we do. There are a number of leaping texts like this one. Set your affection on things above and not on things in the earth. See, now if you can do that, you've been sanctified. That's what we do. We continually leap. We leap into the heavenly places and receive from the good things of God, and we're able to forget this world and to just think on the things that are above. That's evidence that you're sanctified and clean. See, separation. But now, to what purpose are we separated? Purification is not an end of itself. It's a means to an end. God has work for his people. That's the reason for purification. I like the word consecration. Separate unto me Barnabas and Saul for the work. That's why. See, God has work for us to do. That's why we're staying clean. I heard it said one time, you know, salvation is more than God using you. I thought, well, that's a pretty ignorant statement. Because that's the great thing about salvation, is that God can make you clean so that he can use you, so that you can be in his hand for use. I mean, God's not going to put his hand anything dirty any more than you are. Right? Do you do that? I mean, I have, you know, at work, I have things that I have to deal with that are pretty nasty. If you don't know, I'm a trash man, so there are things you have to deal with that are pretty nasty, and sometimes I'll grab like a fork or something out of the trash, you know, because I got to use it for the truck, some things, different things, but I don't use that fork to eat with because it's dirty. So you got to be a fit vessel for a fit use. And the scripture says, ye that bear the vessel of the Lord, be clean. Why? For work. Work. You see, God is a working God. Our introduction to God is this: in the beginning, God created. That's our introduction. It isn't God lounging on the heavenly couch. It's God doing something. That's the God that we are introduced to. David testified, God is my king of old, working salvation in the midst of the earth. God is a working God. Jesus himself testified, and he got in trouble for it, my Father work hitherto, and I work, even on the Sabbath day. In fact, God never rests from his work. Can you imagine how your day would go if God did rest from his work? Be a bad day, wouldn't it? Every time you get a vision of the throne room, whether it's in the book of Daniel or maybe in the book of Revelation, there's always activity, always something going on, right? I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like a fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. That's the context in which you are being prepared to enter into. That's what the work of sanctification is all about, brethren. Heaven and the world to come is not going to be an everlasting retirement. Would you die for something like that anyway? For a golf course in heaven or a good fishing hole? Or people got strange ideas of what they think heaven is, but I can assure you this, it is not a place of inactivity. In fact, our work in heaven will be our rest. Even in the earth, brethren, even in the earth, retirement is overrated. It's just overrated. I'm not against retirement, so don't get me wrong here. I'm not against retirement, but even people that are retired will tell you they've got to find something to occupy their time with. Because leisure and pleasure in entertainment only goes so far, and you finally got to do something a little more meaningful. That's just the way men were made. We were made to work. And sanctification is about you being a vessel prepared for divine employment. In a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use. Amen. That gives purpose and meaning to being clean, is being used by God. And my message is this, that marvelous work of making you fitted to be in the hand of the master is being prepared in the context of your fellowship with Jesus Christ. Of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us. The Corinthian church was not the ideal church. When Paul wrote to that church, he wrote with great care on his heart. He had heard that there were divisions among them. There were some that were saying, I'm of Apollos. Others were saying, I'm of Paul. Others were saying, I'm of Christ. And others were saying, I'm of Cephas. And there were divisions. When they came together, it wasn't for the better. There was competition and striving among them. Believe it or not, they took this great enrichment of all these marvelous gifts that Christ had given them, and it had become a context for competition. Maybe you haven't experienced something like that. Coming together and not being for the better. That's how Corinth was. Paul told them, ye are carnal. There was a man in that assembly that had taken his father's wife, and the people were not humble about it. They still thought they were something when they weren't. If there are sinners sinning among us, this is a reason for humility. Something is not right. Christ does not produce that. Amen. And so Paul was having to deal with that and bring them back to the fundamental basis of the gospel, which is not confidence in self and not confidence in routines and procedures and things like this, but in God and faith in God through Christ Jesus. When a man is prideful, he's very presumptuous about his fellowship with Christ, which is why he's not producing much. So Paul tells them, of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us. God made the first move. That's what the gospel says. You did not choose God. God chose you. I know that there are people that have a lot of difficulty with this, but this is the truth. Even your desire for Christ was an evidence that God was drawing you in the first place. Because Jesus himself said, no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him. You see, when we're thinking about salvation, we've got to start with God. God is the primary worker in salvation. To me, this is one of the amazing things about salvation, is that God can delegate responsibility and still maintain the primary position of being the worker in it. Even when Jesus came, this is what happened. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. God was actually doing what he was doing vicariously through the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said it, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And that's what sanctification is all about. He's actually working through us. Right? So here, he's delegated responsibility to us, and yet it's he that's working in us, right? Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God which works in you both to will and do of his own good pleasure. So who's the worker in salvation? Us or God? Yes. But God is still the primary worker. Of God are you in Christ Jesus. Well, I'm glad for that. This is a reason for confidence. If you've not found out yet, the more you think about yourself and the less you think about Jesus, confidence kind of starts to take wings like a dove and fly away, doesn't it? It's not that God hasn't done something in you, but it's that you're not the primary worker. God never turns the work over to men and sits down passively, ever. Never. He is the worker. And he's the one that puts you in Christ. Now, I think that's very significant, that one of the first things God did when he saved you is put you in Christ. Amen. The scripture says that God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his dear Son. He put you in Christ. Now, this is the wise God we're talking about. And why would he put you in Christ? Because it's in Christ that the surety of the work is accomplished. That's where sanctification does happen, is in Christ Jesus. It's not a method, it's not a procedure, it's not a routine, it's a man. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this, and he still is. And in sanctification, the zeal of the Lord of hosts is the one that is performing this. The scripture says all the promises of God in him are yes. So what are the promises of God? It's an articulation of God's purpose. It's what he intends to do. And God is telling you everything that God intends to do, he is doing in Christ. In Christ. How can we be sure that this work is for sure to be accomplished in Christ? Brother Gene read this text on Sunday, this marvelous messianic psalm from Psalm 69:6. He didn't actually quote this text, but I'm going to quote this text tonight. Let not them that wait on thee, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed for my sake. Now you think about that. Jesus will never let somebody be disappointed who's got an expectation of God and puts their faith in him. He will never let that happen. You will never be disappointed for having trusted in Christ Jesus. Amen. That's Christ's determination. And someone already mentioned it last night. This is like a banner over all that Christ does. He shall not fail. It doesn't say he cannot fail. It says he will not fail. He shall not fail or be discouraged. Jesus is not a quitter. Amen. He never quits. Even when things are very difficult, Jesus does not quit. Tell me, what work do you know that he has failed in? He's the one working sanctification.
Praise God.
See? How can we know it is sure? Because in Christ is a place of abundant provision. See, he's a person, but when you're put into Christ, you're put into a place. You remember when God told Israel, he referred to Israel as like a vineyard. And remember, he took that root and he put it in a place of fertile soil and gathered out all the stones and put a wall about it. Now, that's what he's done in salvation. He's put you in a fruitful field. That's what Jesus is. He's like a fruitful field. You remember when Jonathan had taken upon that garrison of the Philistines and the Israelites were in the middle of battling against the Philistines? You remember as they were going along, they just happened to come down into this wooded area. Well, Saul had made this horrible, horrible vow that nobody was to eat until he had had vengeance on all of his enemies. Really wise, huh? Yeah, let's not give them sustenance, then they'll really be able to fight. But Jonathan didn't know that they had made that vow. When they came down in this wooded area, the whole wooded area was dropping with honey. There was so much of it was all over the ground. And Jonathan took his rod and he dipped down in that honey and put it to his mouth and testified that his eyes had enlightened. Now that's what being in Christ is. It's being in a place where the provisions, so to speak, drop. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places in Christ. You never lack for resources when you're in Christ.
Amen.
Never do. In Christ is redemption. In Christ is the Spirit of life. In Christ is all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Forgiveness is said to be in Christ. The Spirit of life is said to be in Christ. Paul opened multiple letters. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the Father and the Son. And many more things that we could say. He is a fruitful place. And when you are in Christ, you will not lack for what you need. Another way of looking at this, how can we know this work is sure? Because of this. Because when you're put into Christ, you're put into God's workshop, so to speak. Remember when Paul wanted to, or when the Lord took Jeremiah down to the potter's house, and the potter was making a vessel, and the vessel was marred in his hands, and so he remade the vessel. And God said this, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as the potter, saith the Lord. Now I love this language. Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand. When God puts you in Christ, he puts you in the place where his hand is working. You're in his hand. The scripture says it this way, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. That's being in his hand. Well, it's very edifying, brethren, if you can see that.
Amen.
I like what the psalmist said. He said, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the work of thine own hands. Who is he talking about? Himself. Can you see that tonight? You're in his hands. See, it's not primarily what you're doing in sanctification. It's primarily what he's doing. You're in his hands for the work of sanctification. Job said it this way, and you don't want to be outdone by Job because Job didn't have a lot. It's amazing what Job knew. Thou shalt call, and I will answer to thee. Thou wilt have a desire to the work of thine hands. We are his handiwork. That's what we are. We are his handiwork, and he is working in us, and God will not fail as long as you're in his hand. Right? Another reason why this work will not fail is simply this. Our fellowship with Christ by faith is making us like Christ. The more like Christ you are, the more sanctified you will be, if I can say it that way. It's amazing how many different parallels God has used to talk about our, to testify, to affirm this marvelous union that we have with Christ. For example, he says, the man joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. It's a marvelous spiritual union. And then another place he says that we become married to another in order that we might bring forth fruit unto God. So it's like a marriage where the two become one. And then another place of scripture, Jesus says this, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. It's that oneness. Because it's in the context of that oneness that you are becoming more and more like Christ. Who do you know that is more sanctified than Christ? Who is more set apart for divine work than Jesus? When Jesus came into the world, Jesus wasn't part of Adam's race. He told the Jews, he says, you are from beneath, I am from above. In other words, I'm not part of Adam's race. By nature, he was separate. Why did Jesus live separately? Because he was separate. Jesus did not have a sinful nature. And he wasn't tempted by some of the things that people think. I think he's been brought a little too low. At all points, yes, in general principle, but with every single specific detail, I highly doubt that Jesus had difficulty with adultery. He did not have a sinful nature. That does not mean he wasn't tempted. But he was tempted with things like changing stone into bread, things like that. It's different. It's on a different level. Jesus didn't sin because he wasn't a sinner. In fact, he's separate from sinners. He did no sin. Neither was there guile in his mouth. You see, he's the best example of someone that was separate from all defiling influences. At 12 years old, Jesus was separate from personal interests. Not as if he ever was self-centered, but he lived a separate life. Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business? If you're going to work for God, you're going to have to forget yourself. He lived for God. Everything he did. It was his food to do the will of his Father. See, it's separate. Separate. And when we are in fellowship with him, we are becoming separate too. Okay? Let me just give you some examples of this in the scripture. That is through our fellowship with Christ that this is taking place. For example, he says in Romans chapter 8, the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Free, separate. There's no one that is in Christ that is a slave to sin. It doesn't mean they can't sin. It means they don't have to sin. Or think about this. Acts chapter 3:26, he says, unto you first God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. It's one thing to take sin away from you. It's another thing to turn you from sin. You know, the world to come is going to be a world wherein righteousness dwells. If a person has developed a hearty appetite for iniquity, they are not going to fit in. See, these are just practical things. It makes sense. When you look at what God is doing in you as workmanship and you think about what he's bringing us to, this makes perfect sense. Makes perfect sense. We're being separated from self-love. That's something God has to work out of you. And that doesn't always go away right away. You think, well, someone comes into Christ, immediately they're never selfish. That's pretty naive. Sometimes self-centeredness can raise its ugly head where you least expect it, and you got to throw it down. The love of Christ constraineth us. And then he went on to say in that text, he died for all that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves. Haven't you found as you're growing in Christ, you're thinking less about you and more about him? Amen. That's sanctification. That's what's happening. The world to come will be all about God. And when you find yourself delighting more in God than you are in just yourself, you're making progress. Great progress. It also involves separation from the world. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them because they are not of the world. And the more he gives you his word, the more separate from the world you are, right? The less you think like the world, the more you think like the Lord. That's the way it works. And in many other ways, this takes place. But this is the process that we're going through right now of preparing for the world to come. And it is a process. It's not something that happens overnight. It's something that we're in the process of right now. We're in the process of being prepared for that place and that time. But you know, Paul was not only concerned for the Corinthians. He was concerned for the Galatians. He was concerned for the Ephesians. The good fight of faith is just that, it's a fight. Because your being in Christ hinges upon your trusting in Christ. When Paul told the Galatians, you are fallen from grace, who can calculate how serious that is? That you can come into a place where grace is not effective for you. How else do you explain what he meant by that? It was a serious condition because they had been turned aside from faith in Christ. You know, everybody who comes into Christ comes in the right way, by fully trusting in God. That's what a true gospel produces. It produces in a person they're fully trusting in the Lord, see? But then this is the work of Satan and all false teachers, is to take that trust and to divide it to something else. It can be circumcision. It can be some kind of a routine, a religious routine. There are a lot of fads out there today. Fasting. Fast, that's the secret. That's the secret. If you fast, you'll really grow in the Lord. There's all kinds of things like that out there. And we have to fight against those kind of things. Whenever Sister Tasha and I were looking for a house, back after the tornado, we were looking for a house, and it was actually a house that was pretty close to where our house is now. And these people were believers, and so when we were going through the house, we saw there were scripture that was on the walls. It was actually very edifying just to go through the house, look at the house, and see the scriptures. But we went into one of the kids' rooms, and I saw this saying on the wall. Grow where you have been planted. And that stuck with me. If you stay where God puts you, where he puts you in the first place, which is in Christ, you'll become everything God has determined that you should be. And that is not an oversimplification. That's the truth. I understand that requires a lot of fighting, but that's the truth. And Satan's primary objective is to steal you away from Christ by putting your trust somewhere else. You are not saved upon the basis of what you do. You are saved upon the basis of what he has done and your faith in that. Amen. And so I just want to close with 2 Peter 3:18. Peter says this. He says, grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I just want to encourage you, do the same thing. And anytime you're confronted with an influence, it can be a thought, it can be a sermon, it can be a song, it can be anything that is trying to disrupt your fellowship with Christ, walk away from it. Because if you stay where God puts you, when he puts you in Christ in the first place, you'll become everything God has determined and purposed that you should be. Thank you, brethren.